Hi everyone, my name is Stefan Wiefling and this is joint work together with Luigi Loiacono from HBRS University of Applied Sciences and Markus Dürmuth from Ruhr University Bochum. And we're just talking about something that we use every day, Zoom calls. No, I'm just kidding. Of course, we're just talking about something else that we use all day. We're just talking about passwords. And I mean, passwords are just deployed worldwide on the internet and we can't get rid of them because, you know, from a developer perspective, they are like easy to implement. And from a user perspective, if, for example, I show my grandmother this login fields, I think she knows what to do here. So I think everyone comprehends what we can do with these login fields if we have them. However, the risks and passwords are just obvious. You know, if you're just choosing like long passwords, they're like hard to remember, but also harder to crack. And if you're choosing shorter passwords, they are easy to remember, but also easier to crack. And these are just the obvious reasons. But for passwords, the risks have just increased. For example, I probably think you know about phishing, where you just trick users into revealing their passwords with tricks like, yeah, sending an email where you just ask like, yeah, something has changed with your account. Can you please sign in? Just showing them a fake website. Then you just enter the credentials and then you're just getting hacked, for example, because you have to obtain the login credentials here. There are also some attacks which are more targeted where you don't actually need to trick a user into revealing their passwords, which is machine learning based, like intelligent password guessing methods. They're really successful in that matter. If you're interested in that, there are some attacks on that. But, you know, if you're just taking a look into that, these attacks are more like targeted to certain users, but they're not like scalable. And if you want scalable attacks, you should better use credential stuffing because you have like, you know, these password databases, they just got stolen on the internet and sometimes sold on black markets. And now you can take these ones as an attacker and just automatically enter these login credentials on another website in the hope that the users are reusing their passwords, which is quite common. I pled guilty in that as well. I sometimes reuse passwords as well. And these attacks are really like popular. If you just see the numbers of Akamai, for example, they publish some graphs from 2018 where they show how often these credential stuffing attacks happen. And if you just see the details here, there are more like 150 million attempts per day that they detected. And if you even take a look at the peaks here, they're like 250 million plus attacks. And Akamai also said last year that with the beginning of the COVID-19 pandemic, these attacks are even increased over 300 million attacks. So these credential stuffing attacks are a relevant threat right now. So we need to implement some additional measures here to protect our users. And if you're just asking a typical IT administrator in Germany, they'll mostly tell you like, yeah, why not using two-factor authentication? Yeah, seems like an obvious reason. You're always asked for additional authentication. You enter the second factor and then you're getting in. But the problem is here that two-factor authentication is not that accepted by users, as our studies and other studies have shown as well. Two-factor authentication, that's a fact, is accepted by users, but only in terms where you have like a higher degree of security here, which is in terms of online banking. If you're choosing another scenario that is not that high sensitive as online banking, users tend to not accept it. So if you don't have an online banking website, better listen up to the next things I'm going to talk about you, because users do not accept it in other cases. Also, a real life example, if you just take Google, they really had to say that less than 10% of their active Google users have opted in for two-factor authentication. And that's a very low number. And we need to protect these 90% that don't have two-factor authentication enabled. And this is where risk-based authentication comes into play. Risk-based authentication is used by these online services just to protect their users. And this works as follows. You just normal user signing in with your username and your password. And when you submit the login credentials, you're also submitting additional metadata that is available in the context. We just call it the feature set right now. So what kind of IP address am I using? What kind of user agent am I using? And so on. And this is all put together in the risk engine in the back end. And we're just also adding a threshold here because we just calculate a risk score, which is a number between zero and unlimited. And yeah, we need to separate somehow these attackers and legitimate users. And this is why we use an attack access threshold here to determine how likely is the risk that this login attempt is a hacking attempt. And this is just normally categorized into low, medium, and high risk. And if you just take some examples here, I'm just signing in like I normally do. Like I take the feature value here, I'm just signing in from my normal university address. And yeah, risk-based authentication knows that it's really me based on my previous login behavior here. And then I'm getting signed in as always. Now I'm just switching the location here to a location that I've never been before and I probably never will because the financial crypto is not happening in Grenada in real life. But however, if I just take a look at the picture and need to fix that, I think you should always wear a mask wherever you are. So I just added a mask here. Yeah, but even if you're using a mask or not, the system will just recognize if it's really you or not. In this case, because the location and the device is different, they're not sure if it's really Stefan Wiefling trying to sign in here. And in this term, they're just asking for an additional authentication factor. So, for example, like proving that this is the email address, that I've got access to the email address by sending a digit code to the email. If I'm just providing the code correctly, then I'm getting signed in. So basically here you can see the differences between risk-based authentication and two-factor authentication. You're not always asked for additional authentication. So this is why also NIST or NCSC are recommending risk-based authentication to protect their users. And also our previous studies showed that risk-based authentication is accepted by users. They found it more usable than comparable two-factor authentication methods. And also they found it equally or comparably secure, which is a good sign here. But the problem is when you want to deploy risk-based authentication, you need to know about a lot of details. You know, as we saw before, how do I actually need to choose the access threshold? What kind of algorithms should I use? What kind of features do I actually need to record? And yeah, in order to answer that, because like when I did talks about this risk-based authentication before, people just asked me, yeah, Stefan, how often does it really happen actually in practice? And yeah, finally, we can give you answers on that. Luckily, actually, because we did a long-term study, we studied how risk-based authentication behaves on the long-term by having, you know, real user data. And we collected a data set on an e-learning website for students, for medicine students. They just signed in to this online service just to practice for their exams. They did this on a voluntary basis. Yeah, each time they signed in, we collected features and we collected them in a time span of 1 year and 10 months. So that's a really long time span. So we can really observe how these features are actually working. And these were 780 users, and we collected a lot of features here. Most of them are known from the browser fingerprinting literature and RBA literature. And one of them is actually a new feature. I'm not going to talk about what it is, but you probably hear about it later. Yeah, and they conducted a lot of login sessions, most of them actually on the desktop devices, which is probably interesting for you, but it makes sense in this term. This way of online service here because you know, a lot of users need a bigger screen to practice. So yeah, using desktop makes sense here. They also signed in like 12 times on median, and they are signed in on a daily to weekly basis. So it's a daily to weekly use website. Makes also sense because I think most of the students signed in before the exams to practice. So yeah, it makes sense that they learned on a daily basis, hopefully. So here's the data set, and we evaluated this data set on risk-based authentication because now we have the login behavior of 780 users over almost 2 years. And now we needed to evaluate how does risk-based authentication actually react to this data. And we evaluated two different algorithms of risk-based authentication. One of them unfortunately did not perform that well, so we're more focusing on the better performing one, which is what we called the extent model. This model, we found it on popular online services as we observed them in practice. So big online services tend to use it, and it's based on a formula that we found in literature by David Freeman here. And I'm just going to explain how we actually calculate the risk of login attempt here. First of all, we have some feature values for the current login attempt as an input. And then based on that, we're just calculating a lot of probabilities. First of all, is the probability how likely this login attempt or how likely this feature appears in the global login history. So we take the power of all users and just want to see if is that a likely value for a normal user on our website. So, and it's also an advantage because we have the global scores of all users. So it's not that hackable because you need control of all users, which is, I would say, not possible. This is just divided by the likelihood, how likely this user is normally signing in. So how likely this feature values are used by the user when they sign in legitimately. Why are we actually recording that or calculating that risk? Yeah, just imagine you're still signing in with your favorite online browser. Yeah, like the Internet Explorer. And even if you're the only person signing in with the Internet Explorer, we don't want to block you on the website. And if that's just a normal login behavior, the likelihood will be very good if you're just this typical guy that or gal that signs in with the Internet Explorer. So just to observe that here. We also divided, we added some additional information to the risk score here. The additional, maybe you're just a VIP user here. So we're also calculating the likelihood, how likely this user is getting attacked. So if you may be a president with, 84 million followers on Twitter, you probably get an interesting target here. So you probably want to protect them and calculate the risk. Here, we did not do this in our study because, we just had normal medicine students. We probably did not have any VIPs here, but it is just imaginable in practice if you think about that. And this is overall divided by the likelihood how likely this user signs in. So if I'm just a user that signs in on a daily basis, the probability to sign in will get higher than the person that does not log in once a month or something. So makes sense. So I hope you understood the formula. It's a bit complicated, I think. But we evaluated. We need to evaluate the RBA system somehow against some attacker models because, you probably get attacked. So we want to figure out how good it protects against these types of attackers. If you just take the simple attacker, we had an attacker that just knows the login credentials and just signs in from an IP address somewhere in the world. Then we had an attacker that we tested against that is more elaborate, that knows where the user is signing in actually and from which country. So the user IP address can be spoofed with the geolocation of the certain country. And we have an attacker that is very intelligent that knows what kind of city we're using, signing in, what kind of browser we're using and what kind of device we're using. So a very intelligent attacker here. And we just tested it against these three types of attackers. And these are our results. First of all, like I said, the question that is very interesting, how often will actually RBA request for re-authentication in practice? And in order to answer that question, we reproduced the login behavior of our users because we had the data set and for each login attempt that we had in our data set, we just reconstructed based on the timestamp the time where they actually signed in here. And based on that, we just extracted the login history of that user at that time And we had an access threshold where we actually just determined how many attackers can we actually block effectively. And then we're just letting our user sign in legitimately. And then we're just figuring out how often will this user actually get prompted for re-authentication if we just want to block a certain amount of attackers. And what are very good results here is that we could even block the naive and the VPN attackers with almost no impact for legitimate users. So you could sign in as normal and you won't recognize the difference, but we blocked almost all the VPN and naive attackers that we had here. If you just take a more closer look at the targeted attackers, this is also quite interesting. We just reproduced how the medium login number of login attempts that a normal user gets and recorded the login history that we had stored at that time. So if we just sign in 5 times, how often were we actually asked for additional authentication? And we tested that for certain settings here. One of these settings here is the true positive rate is what we called how many attackers did we actually block in percent of these targeted attackers. So we have like 99%, not 99.92% is blocked, for example, and you will get these results. And as you can see, most of these, even if you block like 99.94% of attackers, you will not really get asked for additional authentication. Only in the extreme case of 99.92%, we have still an increasing number of re-authentication requests, but this is still lower than asking every time. So this is quite good. And we can see that in practice, it is rarely requested, which is kind of a good result here. Also interesting to configure RBA is also how much logins we actually need to record here to achieve like a stable setup, because it could be that we always ask for additional authentication until a certain point, and we wanted to determine this point so we know that maybe your system is not active, the RBA system, but only after a certain number of logins. But as our results show, most of these settings that we had here, you mostly just needed one entry to store for a stable setup, except for the 99.92% case here. You needed to collect more than 8 or 9 parts here, logins, until you can make it active here. But it's still very good numbers. So you really, in most cases, to block almost all attackers, you really just need to store one entry and just let it active here. But another question that we also covered was to analyze RBA features, because, what kind of features do we actually choose to achieve good security, and what kind of features do we actually choose to achieve good usability? But so just imagine you have a good feature that blocks all the attackers, but it probably also blocks all legitimate users. So we really need to choose sensible features here. And our results are, identified some features. And actually, one of the first findings that we had here is that from these 250 features that we analyzed, only few qualified for RBA. So this is a very low number. From these 250, only 35 features qualified, and very few really had strong properties. And I'm just going to show you the ones that qualified here. The first one is single features. So we had different categories here, and this feature had high reliability because it's server side originated, because it's server originated. So it can provide good RBA performance on their own, and it's the IP address, quite obvious, because it has like the properties like it's JavaScript is not required. You don't need JavaScript to make this work, which is good. And also we introduced some metrics like the RISC-O ratio, which means how good can I actually, when I just add this feature, how better can I actually increase the distinguishing between attackers and legitimate users. So if the RISC-O ratio goes higher, we can better distinguish between a legitimate user and an attacker here. Also unique values. So we also counted how many unique values are there, in order to find out how spoofable is that. Because just imagine you get blocked after one wrong guess, then if you have a higher number of unique values, they're really harder to guess. We also identified single add-on features. These are also server-originated and they are really high reliable, but you need to combine them with a single feature, which is the IP address here. And the results also showed some features here. You probably know some, like the ASN. So what kind of internet service provider am I using? What's the region I'm signing in? And there's also like timing-based, what kind of login time do I actually sign in? So a classical one. But there's also a feature like RTT. Yeah, really, what is that? MS, okay, that could be like a timing-based one because like milliseconds. T, time, okay, because we have RTT, timing, time must be in here, right? So time, probably the last one, time, okay. RT, road trip? No, I don't think it's road trip time. Round trip time. There we go. Yeah, it's the round trip time. It's a new feature that we just developed for our RBA systems. And it has an advantage that it's based on WebSocket. So it's web technology that is deployed in all the browsers right now. So you can use it. And it's server originated. So this has also the advantage of reliability here. And it works as follows. You have two devices, a device and a server. And the server then sends a ping frame to the device. And the server can decide when they start this procedure, which is an advantage here. And then by the WebSocket standard, the browser must automatically reply with a pong frame. And now we can take these timing differences just to measure how close this user is probably near our devices. So we have the round trip time here, just if you just take the differences between ping and pong frame when we finally get the answers here. And you can really use that to determine if the user is really located in that indicated country here. So if you're just a cheap attacker and you want to save money, of course, you normally use a VPN. And you're outside of the country, so you have some milliseconds to connect to the VPN. And the VPN also has some time that is added up. So at the end, our round trip time can detect if you're behind the VPN because the round trip time just increased. So it's not like 20 milliseconds as you would have had if you're inside the country, but you have like 140. So you can really detect if you're in the VPN or not. And what we also found in the results is that some browsers don't even show it up, like this procedure that I just described here. So the Chrome browser doesn't show it. The Firefox browser did not show it in our testings. The Safari browser actually showed it, but this really indicates that popular online browsers don't really show that feature. So you probably should consider using it. We also identified some features that we called add-on features. These are client-originated ones, so they are not that reliable. But you can use them together with some other features that were more reliable to have an additional signal here. We didn't show it actually up because for timing reasons, but if you're interested in these add-on features, just check our results in the paper where we got the full table of all the features. So just to conclude, we had identified some features, but only few features really were good enough for RBA. So it is also good in terms of privacy because you don't need to collect that much data, which is good. Also, the RBA model that we just tested achieved very low reauthentication rates. So that is good for usability and also blocked a lot of attackers here. So that's also good for security. So it's an ideal just to deploy risk-based authentication. But still, there's a problem in configuration because you really need to optimize RBA for your use case scenario because you still need to determine what type of features are you going to use and how you set the access thresholds. But I think our results can show you some hints how you can actually design such an RBA system. So if you just get any more questions, just drop me a line. I'm on Twitter as well. reachable by email. We also have a website where we have risk-based authentication papers and more studies as well, if you're interested in that. And yeah, if you're more interested in designing a system, just I'm very happy to hear from you. Or you could also like type your comments down into the YouTube comments. You can give us a like all the YouTubers just beg you to do. So you probably do that as well. And yeah, thank you very much for listening. And I'm just very happy to hear from you. So thank you very much.